In this video, we will use the 3-week weighted moving average forecasting method using the 12 weeks of demand data that we have. With the weighted moving average, we have different weights that are given to us. We have weight 1, 2, and 3 in this example set to 0.5, 0.3, and 0.2. Now remember that the weight number 1 refers to the most recent weight. Okay, so we'll start this 3-week moving average at period 4. What we're going to have is we're going to have equal to, it's going to be whatever we have in the previous period. We're going to give that a weight that's specified in the most recent, which is W1, which is in B18. I'm going to put some dollar signs in front of B and 18. Then we're going to give a weight of the second most recent, and we're going to use the weight number 2, which is in cell B19, and I'll put dollar signs on that so I can copy this down. Then we're going to do for the first week, or the third most recent, we're then going to multiply it by weight 3, which is 0.2. I'll put dollar signs on that as well. That will give us our 3-week weighted moving average forecast for week 4. And then when we copy this formula down, we can get the forecast all the way up to period week 13. Let's graph the demand and the 3-week moving average to see what that looks like. I'm going to delete whatever data that Excel has done for us, just in case. We'll make sure we do it. Make sure we do what we're looking for. So the series name for the first one is the demand. And then the X values are going to be the week numbers. And then the Y values will be in column B for the demand. And then we'll add another one, which will be for the 3-week weighted average. X values will again be the weeks, 1 to 13. And then the Y values will represent our 3-week weighted moving average forecast. Okay, I'll click OK. So let's change the scale. Nothing happens below 600. We'll set the minimum to 600. Now let's move the legend over to the right-hand side, and then let's add our axes. Okay, this represents the week number. And then here we'll have the demand. Okay, now let's calculate the errors. It's going to be the demand minus the forecast, or the forecast minus the demand. We get the same result because we'll be either taking the absolute value or the squaring the errors anyhow. Okay, the absolute value of this error. Then we'll do the mean squared error formula that we had before. We'll do the sum of squares. Then we'll divide by the number that we're adding up. So then that will be the mean. Okay, mean squared error. So we'll have sum squared of, it's going to be the error, an M6. We'll put dollar sign so it starts there, and then we'll continue. In this case, there will only be one observation. And then we'll divide by the number of observations, which in this case will be 1. So I'll just put a format. It's going to be a6 times 3. It'll be 1 and then 2 and then so on. Okay, and then the mat that we're going to just do the average of all of the absolute errors that we've had, and starting at N6 and then continuing. In this case, just N6, but then as we copy the formula down, there will be more. So now we've copied all of these down to, we want to go to row 12, so we don't really want the last one. And then let's see what we get for a mat. So we got a mat of 78, and then we have this MSE.